Hello, fabulous friends, fans, and superstars. Welcome to your horoscope for the week of May 17, 2020. I am your astrologer, Nadiya Shah. Thank you for being here. Right out of the gate, as we begin the week, the sun will speak in supreme harmony with Jupiter. This is a type of conversation that astrologers call a trine. If you remember last week, I told you about the sun speaking with Pluto. That energy was one of power and truly effective action. This energy is that action paying off. This can be blessings. Now, normally when we think of these two planets speaking in supreme harmony, this is considered one of the more fortunate celestial connections to take place in the sky. I do think that some of that energy is negated a little bit because it is Jupiter right now that isn't necessarily as strong as he might be in other signs while he's moving through the sign of Capricorn. But still, this can be positive energy that all of us can tap into in one way or another, especially as we are beginning the week. This can be a time to take action. This can be a time to consider what it is that you want to manifest. Both of these planets are in Earth signs right now, with the Sun being in the sign of Taurus. Practical matters and where it is that you can demonstrate a methodical approach, well, that tends to be a winning strategy under this energy. But the energy will shift, as energy often does, and that is on Wednesday. Right around Wednesday, the sun will change signs, moving into the sign of Gemini. So happy birthday to all the Geminis out there. This will begin a Gemini season and brings a focus on mind and has more of us wanting to connect with each other, wanting to communicate with each other. Now, it's very interesting that it is under this particular sky that many of the social restrictions, social isolation that has been taking place, more and more places are starting to announce how they're going to start to ease those, especially as we start to move towards Memorial Day weekend. We're seeing that particularly in the US. And it makes sense considering how social people are going to be itching to be, especially once the sun moves into the sign of Gemini. But we are going to have to be a little bit mindful. And that is because we will simultaneously be having strong Neptunian energy. On Wednesday, Venus will connect with Neptune in a conversation of tension. I spoke about this connection at length in the Venus retrograde special horoscope. I will link to it below. But it is this connection that is dominant throughout the month. It's like it stays and then it stays throughout this month, where normally this would be a passing energy because Venus is now retrograde. It is as if these planets are holding tight all month in this connection of tension. Now, this is magnifying desire. This is magnifying illusion and fantasy and hope as well. But it can be an energy that's very ephemeral, meaning that it is energy that feels not tangible. It is energy where it becomes hard to decipher what is grounded, what is real, and what otherwise would be illusion. And this is going to be that much more heightened once we move later in the week. On Friday is when Mercury will join in the fun, meeting Venus in the sky, speaking with Neptune as well. And whereas Venus and Neptune keep things on a more feeling level, on a more emotional level, on a level of hope, it is Mercury that begins to be infused on a level of our thoughts, on a level of our mind. So we are going to have to be mindful that we are not becoming obsessive or addictive in our thought patterns. We also have to be very mindful of overdoing it in certain patterns. Under this sky, things like alcohol or depressants, which is part of what Neptune speaks to, these can have a very strong effect. These can contribute to a very strong sense of flux, particularly on a level of our thoughts, but it can go even deeper than that on a level that is more heart-oriented, that is more energetically oriented. And so with this energy that feels like it is in flux, it is in flow, the lack of groundedness would be challenging. But I actually think that the new moon this week is going to give us that little bit of a window that we need. You know, there's this famous quote by Maya Angelou who says, when people show us who they are, believe them, right? Everybody pretty much knows that quote. Well, it is Gemini that has to do with people. It's a very social energy. And there will be a new moon this week on Friday, and it will be speaking in supreme harmony with Saturn. This is a trine as well. And I do think that this is going to be that window. And for some, it may very well just be a slim window, but it is going to allow us to see things more practically from a more grounded perspective. It's going to allow us to understand what we need to feel more stable within us. But I also see this larger energy as one of delayed gratification. What that means is where Neptune and Venus and Neptune and Mercury would have us getting very carried away and would have us not just indulging, but overindulging to the point where we may lose our senses, lose our heart, lose our desire, lose our connection to ourselves and what it is that we truly know to be true about ourselves in our heart of hearts. That's how Neptune can work. Neptune can wash away things, but it can also amplify feelings and emotion and desire that much more, have it overtake our heart, overtake our mind. It is ultimately this connection between the new moon and Saturn, both in air signs. Air signs have that ability to practice healthy detachment. They have that ability to separate oneself from emotion and to consider things from different perspectives. And I think that sometimes air signs, especially Gemini, where the new moon is in, and Aquarius, where Saturn is moving through right now, both of these signs are thought or said to be cold, to be distant, to be detached, especially Aquarius. But I actually think that this is part of that sense of understanding that we have different parts of us. We have an emotional self, and we also have an intellectual self. We have that part of ourselves that wants to feel, that wants to be engaged in life, but we have another part of ourselves that is able to consider and contemplate the consequences of those actions, even if in the moment they're going to feel good. And I think that is part of the strength now with this new moon, that ability to contemplate, that ability to take a little bit of a step back and decide, who do we want to be in this moment? Who do we want to be in this situation? And what does taking ownership for our happiness actually entail? Delayed gratification is deeply linked to maturity. This is actually a concept that was explored by Scott M. Peck in The Road Less Traveled. If you've been watching me for a while, you know I talk about this book, Road Less Traveled and Further Along the Road Less Traveled by Scott M. Peck, from time to time because it was so influential to me. And I've actually read these books a few times because I just loved them so much. It's such the exploration of the value of self-discovery, self-development, the value of the therapeutic process, the psychological process, the journey of self-knowledge, why it matters. That's what these books explore. And in The Road Less Traveled, Scott M. Peck talks about how one of the ways in which he can gauge, especially when he's dealing with a new patient that he is planning to see over a period of time, one of the ways that he can gauge how mature this person is, how much it is that they're able to own their life from an adult perspective, how much it is that they're able to own their happiness, is to look at where they are in terms of delaying gratification. Because part of being an adult is to decide what matters. And sometimes that instant gratification, that instant hit, it is not going to be nearly as satisfying as the bigger picture, as the bigger reward. And that's ultimately what it means. We think of delayed gratification sometimes as associated with dieting. Forget that. I'm not talking about that at all. What I'm saying is to have your priorities, to understand that there are richer rewards if we are willing to keep them in focus and to understand that even if they're not here now, they can be if we continue to work towards them. And I think part of Saturn having to do with sacrifice And being intimately connected with this idea of delayed gratification is to understand that some things are more important than the pleasure of the moment. Some things are more important than the indulgence of the moment. The energy towards indulgence is going to be very high, I gotta say. Like I said, there are certain restrictions that are starting to lift in some parts of the world, in some parts of the US. And there are people who are diving right in. They are riding that square of Neptune. They are truly indulging in connecting with other people. And that's fine. You know, it's not our place to judge. But I will say that there are also people, and there is also a way to approach this moment that can interact, that can be connected and find those connections, but to choose them, to decide to approach them with a healthy restriction, with a healthy maturity, and what that means for you. And a part of that is going to mean self-awareness, to understand something about whether it is your own place in terms of your own health, your own understanding of the people you interact with, to make sure that you are not just approaching the interactions you take with maturity, but to know that there are other people that you're going to interact with as well, and to take responsibility for that. And so I think we're going to see these different voices play out under a sky like this. And there are going to be absolute advocates for indulgence. There are going to be absolute advocates for restriction. And somewhere along the way, each of us is going to have to find our own balance to decide what sacrifices are worth it, what sacrifices feel right, what sacrifices are going to get us to that other place. On the other side of it is self-respect and is self-knowledge that is more valuable than anything in the world. Saturn also speaks to immortality, the part of us that ultimately can live longest. It is connected to our legacy. And I think this new moon is going to allow us to have conversation, going to allow us to put together thoughts that then allow us to take into consideration the legacy that we are creating in this moment. This is a powerful moment. It is a historic moment. This is a once-in-a-lifetime window of time that we won't see again in our lifetime. This great pause that we're in, how are we going to engage it? How are we going to move forward at this time? And when we reflect back on our lives, what are we going to say that we did? It is ultimately behaving in a way that allows us to feel good about ourselves years from now. That is honoring Saturn. And that is how self-respect is fortified in a time like this. Now, I also wanted to share a thought. It was actually some information I came across. It was a wonderful interview with Alan Debatan. He has this wonderful YouTube channel, very popular YouTube channel called The School of Life. And he was actually doing an interview with one of the late night shows online, of course, at home editions. And he said something so profound. It just stood out to me. I love listening to him. I love the way that he approaches life, that sense of self-awareness that he likes to cultivate, that sense of wisdom that he likes to cultivate. So I definitely recommend his work. But he said something in this interview that was so profound. He said that a part of the stress that some parents are feeling right now, having to isolate with small children, is the stress of thinking that they need to be perfect. But children don't need perfect parents. They need imperfect parents for an imperfect world. And that reached me very deeply for a few reasons. One is I thought about how many of us might have judged our parents for not being perfect, or at least thinking that they needed to be perfect at certain moments when we would have liked them to be. But ultimately, in this imperfect world, perhaps they were the imperfection that we needed to prepare for this world at this time. But I also thought about how it is that parents can view themselves. Now, I am not a parent. I do have a dog. I do have a dog. I am a dog mom, I guess you could say. And I got a little glimpse into what it is to be a parent. Just a little glimpse, I will admit. It's just a glimpse. But the first week that I had Biggie when he was a puppy, I cried every single day. every single day, I felt like I was failing him. I felt like I wasn't good enough. You know, I felt like I could have done better. And it was quite remarkable. I thought, oh my God, there are parents, moms and dads, especially moms, who live like this, you know, who have this feeling and it continues over a period of time. And this is actually a theme that I think some people have been feeling. And I look at this sky this week in particular. We've got this heightened emotion, right? All this Neptunian energy, it is evoking tears in a lot of us. We can't be perfect. We may have that desire, that expectations. Our thoughts may tell us that we need to be perfect, but we can't. We are going to fall short no matter what we're doing, but especially when it's something as big as being responsible for another life. And I think with a sky like this, we are going to see this very distinction. On the one hand, this sense of recognizing our own imperfection, but also the stability, the inner sense of self-knowledge that comes when you embrace your imperfections, when you realize that you don't have to be perfect in anything that you do. Because it is our imperfections that make us endearing to others. Now that may be our children, that may be our friends, that may be our larger communities, but it is the reality of imperfection that ultimately, strangely enough, brings more groundedness, the acknowledgement that there are different ways to go about it, we are having different thoughts about it, and yet we're gonna find a way to do our best. And what is our best? Normally, it is, to the best of our ability, to take a more mature approach. Now, sometimes that mature approach is just rooted in how we're thinking about something. To choose to not think about something in dire language, in depressive language, but instead to root ourselves in what we are actually being shown. That can be a mature approach. But what can also be a mature approach is to realize that we really are doing the best that we can today to practice acceptance. There's something liberating about practicing acceptance, with saying, you know, maybe this is the way it needs to be now. There's a glimpse into wisdom that we garner when we approach our lives that way. And with this beautiful new moon, I think we are going to get a glimpse into this very type of wisdom, a wisdom that is embodied, that is grounded, that practices acceptance, but also understands the value of surrender, that is able to own our lives, own our happiness, and then do our best and surrender the rest. That is the power of clarity. That is the power of the new moon this week. What I love about this week for us, well, look, there's so much here. I do love that new moon. All that Neptunian energy, emotions are going to be running very high. Chances are a song is going to come out that some people absolutely love and some people absolutely don't. So it may feel like some music or piece of music goes viral in some way. But this can also be a time when it's hard to discern what's real and what isn't. Now, whether that is in terms of the news or whether what we're talking about, but it looks like there is such elusive and foggy energy and information out there that our strength is in surrender. Our strength is in trusting those moments where we're able to see what is actually being demonstrated, not just what we feel, not just what we hope, but what is the practicality demonstrating to us? And it is a sky like this that also gives us great insight into ourselves, our thought patterns, and to understand how simple observation can transform thoughts into something much more loving, much more future focused, not just in a hopeful way, but in a grounded way, knowing that we truly can not only have anything that we are willing to work for, that's part of the lesson of Saturn, but also that we prioritizing that sense of our self-respect, we prioritizing the higher values that we hold for ourselves, for each other, we prioritizing what it means to be an adult and to engage each other on a level of maturity. Well, that is one powerful way to find maturity within oneself and the freedom that brings. With a sky like this, freedom comes through responsibility, not from responsibility. Those who try to evade it are going to find themselves diving into very deep, very elusive waters. But those who own this truth will find genuine liberation through mind and heart. Well, thank you so much for watching. What do you love about this week? Let me know in the comments below. I love reading you guys. And of course, if you want to know how all this wonderful stuff this week speaks to you and your sign, log on to nadiyashah.com. Sign up to be one of my superstars. Superstars get expanded exclusive videoscopes each and every week, unlimited access to special horoscopes and more. All of this in the superstar space. I look forward to meeting you there. I have books. Thank you for the love that you show my books. The most recent book is Prayers to the Sky. And the book before that was The Body and the Cosmos. This is what I call astrological magic light. So it shows you how I like to work with the planet. The subtitle is To Know and to Love the Astrological Planets More Deeply. And it is about cultivating a relationship with the astrological planets. The Body and the Cosmos is me taking Plato's ideas and applying it to an astrological sky. So this was a lot of fun to do. It really shows off the nerd in me. And so I hope you love that. This is exploring the astrological, philosophical, and physical connection. My first book, Astrology Realized, it still gets a lot of love. This book is 7 years old this week, which is really exciting to me. Again, thank you for making this a consistent thing that people reach for, that people share their love for, that people continue to purchase. Thank you so much for that. And my upcoming book is The Universe is Wise and Loving, Volume 1, The Nodes of the Moon. Now, there's just a few days left to purchase the advanced copy. Advanced copies are set to go out. I'm going home at the very end of the month in order to ship these, sign the books and ship them. So there's just a few extra copies if you want the advanced copy, which comes with $200, more than $200 worth of free gifts. You'd be very welcome to have a look at that. And it includes a special Synchronicity University class that I will be doing for advanced purchase buyers. Now that class itself cost $35, and that is going to be exploring the nodes. Right now, recently, sign of Gemini is where the North Node has moved, and Sagittarius is where the South Node is in. So you get a class pass to that and so much more. So again, I hope you absolutely love it. This book will be available for sale online and wherever books are sold, August 22nd. That is the official launch date, but the advanced copies are shipping really, really soon. And speaking of Synchronicity University, I have a brand new session that I just launched. And so there is time to choose your tuition rate. There are also scholarships available as well. I'm very aware that this is a time where a lot of us have been home, want to learn more, especially astrology, are engaging more with online classes. So you would be very welcome to sign up, choose your tuition rate as low as $5 a class, but also you can apply for a partial or full scholarship as well. All of that is at synchronicityuniversity.com. Now, summer school is going to be amazing. We are going to do Uranus part 1 and 2, Neptune part 1 and 2, and then Mars. So later on, we are going to have this month, at the end of the month, we're going to have, or actually this coming Saturday, we're going to have Mars in the astrology chart as part of the current Synchronicity University session that is taking place for the summer school session part 2, which is Mars in aspect to planets and points in the astrology chart. That's what we'll be looking at. So there's so much here that we are going to be exploring together, and I hope you absolutely love it. I'm a big lover of the outer planets, of the transpersonal planets, all of it. I love the sky. What can I say? But yes, you can get my take on the astrological sky, take lessons with me with synchronicityuniversity.com. So sign up for summer school now at the link below. And if you just can't wait that long, this coming weekend, Memorial Day weekend, I will be teaching along with a star-studded faculty with NORAC, which is now online. NORAC is a phenomenal event that has decades of history. This is the first time they're doing it entirely online. And I will be part of a truly renowned faculty. It's such a privilege, such a pleasure to be part of this. And so you can learn a lot more about NORWAC, taking classes. There's going to be five tracks of classes going on simultaneously. All those classes are going to be available for 2 weeks. I think there's something like 100 classes available altogether as part of the conference pass. Maybe I'm exaggerating there, but maybe I'm not. Yeah, I think it's about 100, maybe a little bit more. So it is a pretty phenomenal moment and a pretty phenomenal event. So I'm going to invite you to go online, and again, links are in the description below to learn all about it and look into signing up for the NORWAC conference. And finally, you can get my take on your birth chart, your natal chart, thanks to my partnership with Cosmogram. With Cosmogram, you can go online, enter your birth data, purchase a natal chart reading, and within hours, it will be emailed to you, it'll be delivered to you. It is your natal chart and my interpretation of your birth chart in printed, written form. It really is so exciting to be part of this partnership with Cosmogram. These reports have gotten incredible feedback. Thank you so much. I've made it such a popular offering through the Cosmogram website. And so please look into that, check it out. This is me going through each of the planets in your chart, looking at them by sign, by house, and the aspects that they make to other planets. So this is a powerful roadmap, really, a very powerful tool that you can refer to again and again. I had my very first printed natal chart reading 25 years ago. And that started me on this journey of astrology that has been just such a beautiful road to travel so far. I still have that printout. I still have that reading. And so I hope that you cherish this reading for a very long time. I hope you gain something from it, you reflect on yourself, you learn about yourself, and just all good things. So again, links in the description below. And thank you. Thank you so much for this moment with you. I look forward to connecting with you guys at summer school, Synchronicity University. That's going to be a lot of fun, diving into Uranus, diving into Neptune, and of course Mars as well, looking at how these outer planets speak to you in your chart. But just this moment, having this moment of sharing with you, it just truly means so much to me. I am here to affirm love and wisdom in the world. And I've been here on YouTube for a while. And whether it's your first time watching me, whether you've been watching me, thank you. Thank you so much. And again, thank you for watching. And it'll be a great week. Enjoy.